Actually, if you move to a larger planet.
Yeah,
you would have more time.
Yeah, that's right. Time in the day.
And actually, Albert Einstein found out something. It depends on your position. Sorry. Talking too much about physics.
So, beide sind normal. Beide sind an.
How do you pronounce your name right?
Audrey.
Yeah.
Muss mal gucken. Maybe the guys in the background.
His mind will be complicated. Everybody's struggling.
Yeah, pretty good.
Thank you.
Like old German Fritz.
No, it's not. It's not.
Yeah.
It's in the region, but also only rarely in Norway.
Thanks so much. That's really nice.
No worries.
Halten?
Ja, wie lange kurz denn die Stunde? Wenn Sie die Stunde nicht haben,
dann
aufbauen.
Wir können es ja lose halten, also das ist ein bisschen, dass ein bisschen atmet oder so.
Based on the people's positions, but also things that are really so advanced that no departments or ministry know how to handle. For example, the UberX case we're handled this way, where we have this online AI-mediated discussion where people express what they want or don't want from the shared passenger kind of stuff. And we use a machine learning algorithm to sort people into principal components and clusters. And then to have majority opinions gathered, even though people may disagree on things, people still agree on things like insurance taxation and so on. And then we take those majority opinions and have a face-to-face celebration. And it's
only about the things people disagree.
Well, actually, only about things people agree, because people agree on those things are as important values. And then we ask all the stakeholders, including Uber and taxi drivers and whatnot, what kind of regulations do you think are useful to address these people's common feelings. But we also talk about contested points, of course, but we don't usually spend too much time on it. We just respect people have different feelings about some basic fact. But the idea is that address these people's common feelings is a win already. Right? And then we turn it into regulation. But the point here is that when thousands of people participated online and watched the live stream, it creates a tremendous pressure on people to both show up and also act reasonably. So this is how we did, for example, things like sharing economy right now, social enterprises, and like improved vehicles, and all sort of new things that doesn't neatly fit into one main space. And of us, we do it like this. And so, because we meet both in real space and also online, and we want to give people practice this thing over live stream, the same participation feeling as people here, right? So we explore a lot using augmented reality, virtual reality, so that people can wear a headset and feel that they're part of the discussion place, and also so that we can project people's consensus around specific points or specific place in time as one of the objects of discussion, like if we're talking about city planning, I can project the city right here for us to talk about as a interactive model or such. So that's the idea. So we're
probably have to repeat all that one.
Yeah, no, it's okay. It's okay. Yeah, so these are some of the scenarios
yeah.
that we're trying to design both in a room-based VR and also in SFS VR and mix those two together. Yeah.
freedom to do a lot of things.
That's right. It's an internal struggle.
Yeah, it's always kind of so mine with the Jew just kind of try to get to a natural conversation, right? And then it's always kind of hard when the setup's not working right and you kind of don't talk yet as well. So
of course, we can talk about the setting as well. So how do you review the footage?
So they do the cat back in person, and I'm about to see the first episode of Mongolia when I'm back, or maybe even before. It's for me like a whole format, it's kind of there's no external speaker or moderator. So kind of they try to use all these little scenes or the voice and then other leg and other pictures. And I can't really from the setup until you imagine how it's gonna be like. Yes. It's just I think it's gonna be exciting to see what the overall message of it is and how the whole form is gonna be perceived.
So the Mongolia is going to be your pilot, or is
it's the first one. It's going to be the pilot, and it's going to be aired on a weekly basis. And so it's 10 episodes. And, I kind of like to do this because this is something totally different. It's a challenge as well.
So it's going to be for a German audience? So is
no, it's going to be the German research and station which is sending abroad to the German people. So it's going to be aired on this, which is cool.
Yeah, look
yeah.
Forward.
Yeah. So, be able to see it here, which is cool. So, I think I just like for the sake of
it. It's great for discussing.
Of course, so it's not that's so much more money. It's really about the experience for me. So, I don't do something else.
That's great.
Okay, ready to go.
Cool. Right. Ori, it would be great if you could introduce yourself because I think I'm not really sure if it could be adequate. Of your position in Germany.
Okay, I'm Audrey Kong. I'm digital minister here in Taiwan. As a digital minister, I don't have a digital ministry, but rather works as a minister with a portfolio, meaning that when there's new digital stuff like e-gaming or things like that, that doesn't really neatly fit into any of the ministry's purview, then I help the premier to make sure how exactly should each ministry handle this. And if one of the ministries think, you know, this is cross-ministry stuff, I also help the ministries to communicate to the premier.
So you pretty much insert yourself wherever you need it then?
That's exactly right. While other ministries with a portfolio have their specific, you know, ministries to worry about, because the digital transformation really covers all the ministries, so the participation officers come from literally every ministry in the administration.
So that my understanding is pretty much sounds like agile software development where you kind of do a lot of different things. Yeah.
That's exactly right. We run on a weekly basis where we have, you know, stand-up meetings every day and then also offline and online, you know, Kanban boards and notes and things like that. We used to record our roadmap in Business Origami. So all those, you know, tools that people use in startup and on a weekly iteration cycle is mostly how I run this public digital innovation space.
That sounds great, but I sometimes could not imagine that the people are not kind of used to software development, that kind of working method. Isn't it hard to work with them?
Not at all, because the public digital innovation space works on a volunteer basis. So only people who volunteer to work in this space, currently about 20 people, get into this culture. So we're not forcing you know, all the ministry to transform overnight into this digital way of working. Rather, we're working in a prefigurative way of demoing how this works and maybe spread gradually to the other ministries.
So since when are you doing this?
Since last October.
Last October. And are you happy with what? You, as you said, you're pretty much dependent on how other people are working together with you. And could you give me an example of something which you have been doing and you, a lot of other ministries were involved?
Sure, of course. So we work on the e-petition case, where people who have the counter signature of about 5,000 people online gets a guaranteed response from the ministries. Now, if the petition is just for one single ministry, of course, it's relatively easy to handle. But sometimes we get those petitions that involves a lot of different ministries. For example, there was just one about a southern part of Taiwan, Hengchun, which really lacks medical resources. And the petition was to ask for the Ministry of Interior's helicopters to be stationed there to work as ambulance so that they could be transported.
All right,
to
nearby. W's.
Right, exactly, so it's W's. But it's actually involving the Ministry of Health and Welfare as well, and also the Army, and a lot of the very different stakeholders who everyone has a different solution to this problem of medical assistance. So what we did was we went all the way to Hengchun, the southernmost part of Taiwan, and held about 20 to 40 people deliberation there. And then we projected this in live stream and allow people all over Taiwan to both watch how we gather the facts and check everybody's feelings, but also provide their input as the deliberation is going. And so the legislators also practiced their expertise on suggestion of how exactly to solve this problem. So it's not just from the administration, but some legislators as well. And after a full day of this kind of deliberation, we finally settled on a few ways to improve their local medical situation by improving the hospitals and improving their transportation and things like that. Mm-hmm. And then just recently, the premier visited and tried to make good on the promise of the deliberations held there. So I think it was pretty successful in both getting all the ministries lined up together, but also let people know that when they have a petition, no matter which ministry takes the petition, every ministry is actually the same government and answers people in a way that is equal, like peer-to-peer, instead of telling people what to do best. We are now trusting people to come up with ideas and their feelings of their local wisdom.
If you so will, it's a more democratic way of, well, more agile and democratic way of running a company.
I'm very sorry, I have to interrupt for a minute. I have to change frequencies because of distortion.
This channel. No. I have to say everything.
No.
It's really interesting.
So excuse me, I should get to the device again. If you just get it out. So this is a test. 1 2 1 2 1 2. Can you hear this? And
yes.
Would you say it's nice and clear the way it should be?
Yes.
No distortion, nothing.
No.
Okay. Thanks. That's it. Okay. It was fine in the beginning, but then it. Das wird become worse. So, 1 2 1 2. Hoffe, ich hast es gehört. Gut. 1 2.
Vielleicht hast du ihn ein bisschen hallig.
Hallig. Ja, der kommt ja auch aus dem.
Nein, jetzt sag ich falsches.
Aus dem Fall hallig.
Okay, everybody. Let's play again. Yeah. Sorry about it.
No worries.
So good. Okay, I'm running again. Oh, the cameras.
What? To me, this. Sounds fantastic, like a more agile and straightforward way to deal with these issues.
Yeah.
Is it like that? Well, I would imagine that some kind of people who are not used to this method, they're kind of, well, do they all kind of agree with the method, or do you have voices of being concerned of dealing with issues like this?
Well, not at all, because the ministry's participation officers from each ministry vote every month on the cases that we want to be treated this way. So,
so
it's also democratic internal.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. It's great. Mm-hmm. So I heard you're a software developer, or have been, right?
Still am.
So, and how you balance these two different things?
It's the same thing.
It's the same thing.
Yeah, and rewriting the country's operating system. We start from the kernel.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good. And it's like time-wise no problem for you to balance the two things.
not at all, because the whole idea is for me to act as a vehicle of radical transparency to people. So all the interviews that I give, I take a copy of myself and publish it on social media. And also all the meetings that I chair internally, I take a full transcript and send to all the participants to collaboratively edit on their EagerPad and for 10 working days, and then publish it to everybody. So basically my work here is like a bridge to the open cultural or free culture movement and the government itself. So I work on all the automation tools to simplify the transcription, to simplify the translation, to simplify the recording, simplify the facilitation.
And
the
development process, basically.
Exactly, a continuous integration of people's voices. So that's
so
my main work. So,
yeah,
so it is a software, actually, architect's work. Yeah.
Very good, cool. When does this role of ministry got established in the first place?
There was always some minister with a portfolio taking care of digital affairs.
Mm-hmm.
Before me was Jacqueline Tsai, so-called cyberspace minister. And before her, we have, for example, Simon Zhang and other people. And it's interesting because Simon used to be a director of engineering at Google. Jacqueline Tsai used to work in IBM Asia as a director of law, and I used to work with Apple. And so we all come from, you know, this world where we talk a lot about agile, of being responsive, of being user-centric, and things like that.
It makes so much sense.
Into practice.
Right.
Yeah. So it's been like that for years now.
Okay, cool. What do you think is the biggest struggle for Taiwan? It's like, understanding this week, I've been here, and I learned a lot, all this economic risk due to the manufacturing of electronic devices,
mm-hmm.
right? And I also learned that all the big manufacturers are also in China right now,
mm-hmm.
not meant to manufacture in there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think like this transformation from being kind of just hardware-based
mm-hmm.
Industry to being more software-based is
mm-hmm.
probably the big challenge Taiwan is facing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. It's basically we have a very good working relationship with machines and silicon and chips and semiconductors, but now we need to work with relations with people,
mm-hmm.
with interaction design, service design, also design work, and that was not what Taiwan is known for. So, but a lot of Taiwan's younger generation are actually very talented in this regard. So a lot of things that government does is just to mix the older generation who are super good at doing semiconductor stuff, and younger people who have a better working relationship with social value, with people, communities, concerns, and things like that, and make sure that they work in harmony instead of contradicting each other.
So would you say the government, I mean, you're part of the government, but do you think they fully recognize that this is the transformation that has to happen for Taiwan?
Well, we are working on the so-called digital nation plan, and it's an 8-year plan. And we know fully that the bureaucracy or the professional career public servants were raised in an era where the fields have very delineated demarcations between the fields, right? So people were trained in one field or the other, and they seldom talk to each other. But now it's very cross-disciplinary, interdisciplinary. While we were changing our curriculum to reflect this fact, we can't just change everybody who worked in the public service overnight,
mm-hmm.
which is why this is an 8-year plan and not an 8-month plan.
Mm-hmm.
So we recognize the difficulty in tackling this, but we're also recognize we're not alone. All the governments everywhere is working on digital transformation, so we have good, you know, friends
mm-hmm.
to share notes and learn from each other.
Cool. So if we've talked about the future, like we think about how this Taiwan or this transformation is going in 5 years' time.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have goals where you can say, oh, I want these things to be changed,
mm-hmm.
or would you imagine
mm-hmm.
Taiwan in 5 years' time?
Well, I would like the public service to trust people more. I think that's my main mandate going in, because trust, as you can see, is mutual, right? And somebody has to move first. And if there is a growing distrust and the idea of disempowerment from the citizens, because they're used to a lot of online communities where people have very close relationships almost overnight, it's called Swift Trust, while the public service is still working on a month-based iteration cycle. Of course, it feels that people are becoming more distant with public servants. On the other hand, the public servants also feel that there may be populism, there may be rumors, there may be a lot of things that sounds like noises, no signals, right? So my main work, I think, which will take at least 20 years, not 5 years, is just to get the government see that the all the different dissenting voices and all the so-called noises are actually signals, and we have a good demodulator that turns the dissents into data and into that people, something that people can focus on and have a conversation with. And when the public service trusts people this way through transparency and participation, maybe some people will start to trust the public service as partners, but never more than how the public service is trusting the people. So somebody has to move first. Mm-hmm. So that's my main idea, and I think it would take a generation or so for the government to trust people by default.
Mm-hmm. I would say so. It's a great approach. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cool. That was my.
Can I add something?
Go ahead.
Can I just re-describe your double function, minister and so you run from the ministry back to your company, or how does it work in your everyday life? So
No. It's not like I'm part time or anything. It is just the previous ministers with that portfolio working in this position were also from international companies, but they of course quit their job before becoming a minister. It's not like they're part-time. Mm-hmm.
Do you always want to do this, working for employees?
Well, for me it's more or less the same kind of work. I used to work in the Perl community, working on a new language, the Perl 6 language, and it also involves talking to a lot of stakeholders, coming to consensus, traveling all over the world to gather people's you know, imaginations and expectations of what a new language is going to be and so on. And it is actually governance, in a sense, just like people in IETF or ICANN. They're actually doing political work without being in the UN or in a sovereign state. It's what we call the multi-stakeholder governance model. And so when I brought in this model here as part of so-called the V-Taiwan project and the other projects, it was explicitly modeled after the standard bodies. A multi-stakeholder model instead of the old voting model. So we don't vote, we reject votes and kings. You surely know this, right? We believe in rough consensus and running code. It's just the running code is not just algorithm in this case, it's actually regulations and policies. But the fundamental idea of anyone who can declare themselves to be a stakeholder, we welcome them to show up and to have a focused conversation. That remains the same as the open multi-stakeholder model. So I think I've been more or less doing exactly the same work, but I'm very fortunate that we have a cabinet where not only the premier and me are independent, there's more independent ministers than minister of any party. So we can focus on this policy as well without being seen as, you know, betraying some parties or things like that.
Cool.
So,
put this away. So
yeah, I'd like to have things in my hand.
Yeah, you can. That's
all right. I got the glasses.
Needs a different toy.
I'm just curious if you ever, I don't want to say dreamt of, but did you really want to be a minister? Why did you do that step to take a political action as well?
Well, I mean, why not, right? But to answer this more seriously, after the Occupy, the Sunflower Movement, the demands of people of radical transparency has really soared sky high, so that everything that the government does not publish is seen as secretive and not to be trusted. So there is a real trust crisis going on around that time. So as someone who specializes in design and social interaction and social network systems and social media systems, I see this as a very good opportunity of doing a demonstration in a national-wide scale of how exactly can digital tools help people not just to speak freely. We have so many tools where you can speak to millions of people, but we don't have that many tools to listen to millions of people usefully, or have millions of people listen to each other. And because that was my research interest, I think why not, right? To have this kind of demo field to actually develop a set of tools that can transfer across different contexts and cultures to really get millions of people listen to each other at scale. So this, I think, is my research interest. So my main boss is actually still research, but I'm very fortunate to have this space where I can explore these ideas.
Are you in direct contact with someone?
We have again a bad on this frequency, another problem making this question.
On this question?
Yes, in the last answer there was some frequency issues. You always can use this one. It's like not as present, but you just try it
eventually.
Is there anything you would say that is missing to startups in Taiwan that they need urgently? Something?
Well, it used to be that our company law was preventing some structures that the startups really need, such as not having their stocks diluted after a few rounds of investment and things like that, which is why a lot of startups went to Cayman Islands or other places to set up company law. But thanks to our previous digital minister, Jacqueline Tsai's effort and the V-Taiwan community's process, we actually fixed that in the company law, where you can now have a closely held company where you have special voting rights and things like that. And at the moment, we're still expanding on the closely held company law concept so that people can have different voting ways in the closely held company and things like that, to make sure that startup people end up realizing their mission or their social value and things like that. But I think the company law itself, while being a very fundamental law, I would also like, and this is speaking personally, to see, because in our act, there's the first clause that says a company exists to make money, to earn a profit. But if we compare internationally, there's a lot of company laws that already allows people to allow different social missions, social values, or environmental values, and so on, without getting sued by their shareholders. So this shareholder to stakeholder shift as part of social innovation and so on, I think is something that really needs to happen, because otherwise we have people who are just for the money and people who are in the NPOs who just care about social and environmental value, and then they gradually don't speak the same language, and we have a lot of, in the startup world, fights even over the related values, but they don't have to be at odds. There could be social innovations that are sustainable while taking care of the environment and so on. So I think personally that's something that really needs to happen, and we're reflecting that in the new company law revision that's about 2 months from now.
Yeah, this was a little bit what we talked about today, about doing the right thing as a company.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We talked in an interview and we talked about, I was asking Friedel why he did found a company, and we talked about, does a company have to do the right thing or just the money-wise thing?
That's the question is if you're in for the money or if you're in for a passion, right? So
that's right.
That's like, I don't see it necessary that, like, it's great if the purpose of company is like also by law not necessary that you have to make money. To me, like in my founding history, I didn't care about the money. It was really about fulfilling a passion and enabling other people.
That's right. That's the enabling, the empowerment, the social purpose.
Yeah.
And it would be good if the company can just declare it publicly to investors, so everybody knows what happens.
I think it's great to kind of have that in there, right? It's possible also to do it without, but it's kind of a quirk or a workaround to it.
Exactly. And always, of course, when the next shareholder comes, it dilutes, and maybe people who hold a small amount of shares want to sue you or whatever, right? So it's easier if the governance structure recognizes this double bottom line or triple bottom line explicitly. I think that's what really needs to happen.
Yeah, and I agree, like, on the wrong one, you might start, like, some startups really start out idealistic and, like, have this value, but but then over time, and the more money gets in, and the more kind of investors focus on return on investment,
mm-hmm.
the more kind of this gets diluted, right?
That's exactly right.
Yeah. So, and I see if it's in kind of the written foundation, it becomes another thing because it's written in there.
Yeah, and it also changed the investors because they already see the corporate social responsibility and things like that, but this actually locks them to a specific vision, and they can also endorse this vision in addition to the startup team. So that one example is, I think, in the gaming industry, of course, you know the ID company released as open source all the old games that they do two
yes.
generations before.
Yeah.
And I think this is very good for the commons, for the whole ecosystem.
Yeah,
so you can also see this as a social purpose
yeah.
to further the understanding of the industry, things
yeah.
like that. And even if the game doesn't sell, even if the company fails, it still has a contribution to the environment and to the society.
It does, yeah. It is kind of, yeah. You make money with this, like with this concept for some time, and after all, you're willing to give back and
mm-hmm.
kind of share that as part of something
mm-hmm.
before you're willing to share that.
Yeah, and we're seeing that in software, it's so natural now. Open source has already won, but in other industries, they're still learning about this.
Yeah, no, I think it's a great principle.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Order, one last question. You said you work for Apple.
I work with Apple.
With Apple.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just wondering, comparing, like, for instance, the American startup culture and the Taiwanese
mm-hmm.
startup
mm-hmm.
culture. Could you describe me the Taiwanese entrepreneurial mindset?
Mm. That's a great question. So I think a lot of this generation of Taiwanese entrepreneurs, they really start with some social issues, with something that they want to solve, with some people they want to enable. There's a lot more social mission in the Taiwan startup scene than you know in the Silicon Valley. But that's not surprising because Silicon Valley is all about the next unicorn nowadays. But I think this really reflects something about why people want to start a small or growing into a medium business. It's because there's a part of society they care, a part of the social problem they want to solve. But this also talks about the relative lack of venture capitals on very high risk companies. So it's a double-edged sword. It both means that there is a very very good supporting SME network, but this also means that for the next unicorn to happen in Taiwan, we really need to get people into who want to take more risk into a position where they can take more risk without being seen as you know too crazy or something. So I think there's a curve, right, of people who want to take risk, and social entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs in general are already people who want to take more risks. But I think we can structure the society and the market so that people don't see failure matter as much, and as people you know share their postmortems or their whatever they've learned during a failure, they're still recognized as part of the community, the standing. And if we can learn this part of the Silicon Valley culture, not other parts, I think this will also grow Taiwan's startup scene into something that is even more diverse than currently.
Cool. Yeah, that's what I had in mind. Little
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's great. It's like, I have to say, I'm really impressed.
Okay.
The approach is great. And if I can think, well, I would love to see these topics handled in Germany, but it's pretty much like how it is, right? I mean, it's familiar to me, this is like you're using all the software analogies. But I think in software in itself, in this industry, it's about coordinating a lot of creative people to accomplish one task, right?
That's right.
And accomplishing one task with a lot of people that all have the same mind and also their own ideas.
Mm-hmm.
It is that you need systems where everybody gets recognized for their idea, but still you have to align them in order to work towards one goal. That's pretty much what polarization should be about, right? So I think it's just a natural thing to do it that way, but I never thought about doing that exactly like you described. So it's interesting.
Yeah. We call that scalable listening, and I think that's just politics it is.
And I see the energy, right? Because, yeah, it is in the end of the day. People want to be seen, want to be heard, want to know they're recognized. Even like that's the idea of having a digital democracy, right? So you vote for something you want, like, and that's the thing. But I think it's missing out on the return channel from the government that you really see you make a difference by your contribution. This is something I don't feel always recognized for whenever I do vote?
Yeah, if you vote, it's just, you know, 2 bits every 4 years.
Right.
The you know, there's a lot of asymmetry, right? You download so much from the government, but you upload only 2 bits every 4 years.
Yeah, on the other hand, I see the concept of voting for people that kind of are then in charge for me doing stuff. But I still, I think the amount of transparency you want to bring in of the process is something that in the end enables trust. So that was also one thing I learned through running a company with 200 people. Like, if I do transparency and I give about the numbers and I tell them about the strategy, only then people can follow the way I think, the way
right.
I want to solve problems.
Right.
And it's what, like, I see transparency as a foundation for trust.
Yes, and in the startup world, even if they're not open source, they all adopted open governance, right, where all the customers see what the priorities are and even participate a lot of structured feedback and so on. And we're actually now redesigning our text filing software because of a petition from a designer that says, you know, Mac can't really file taxes as well. And then we're redesigning it so that we're including, you know, telemetry and user experience research and things like that, so that the designers can have their inputs while we're doing the text filing software. And I think what's important about this is not just one piece of software, but a fundamental rethink of government services into the startup world's idea of working with the people, not for the people.
Mm-hmm.
Because previous, you know, shrink wrap, you know, proprietary software idea, it's all developing for the people.
Right.
And Redmond knows very good what personal computers should do, and people just download one, you know, version after another every year. But now even Microsoft have moved to collaborate with the customers instead of for the customers. So I think there's the whole governance change that is happening just this moment.
Yeah, and I think you can draw the analogy as well as if you're a commercial producer of software and you have customers, you only can produce a great piece of software if you really know your customer.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to collect data, you have to serve them, you have to really understand. I think the time of not listening to the customer is kind of over, right?
Exactly. It's the last entry.
That's great. And like I was always saying, it's like the purpose of a company is to solve a problem for the customer.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't solve a problem for the customer,
mm-hmm.
there's no, like, why should the company even exist?
That's exactly right.
And you could adapt the same principle to the government, right?
Exactly. Yeah,
and sometimes you don't feel that.
Well, as a conservative anarchist, my ultimate vision, of course, is for the people who have the kids to run the governance system themselves. But of course, it will take more than a lifetime. But the idea is just to make sure that everybody knows transparently how government works, and this is the foundation toward a more, you know, anarchistic
More like you can see the living government, like as if you would show a picture of all the things are working together, and you can zoom in and see this picture of.
Right. I used to use a metaphor where the politicians are people, you know, for example, steering a bus, and people who are passengers, right? And while, of course, skilled drivers save a lot of time, it would be best if they have GPS systems and everybody have the same transparency map where you can see
what's happening
and so on. But at some point, when people know how the government system works, how career public servants work, I think it's like the car itself. Maybe we'll move to semi-autonomous driving, where people can then know how governance itself works without having someone to make decisions, or you make decisions only when the car is about to ram into something, right? So I think we're gradually moving this way as long as we trust the collective intelligence.
Yeah, and I think being able to, like, don't want to do this all the time, get into the weeds and like really dive deep and look at something. But you might want to do that once in a while. And I would assume if I take a weekend and just take a deep dive and really can see it, it's going to lead to a lot of trust.
That's
and I don't want to do it like on an everyday basis, but the feeling that I could is a game changer.
Yeah, and with machine learning, as long as we get sufficient raw materials, of course it can adapt interactively to your inquiries or make useful infographics according to your taste and so on. It used to be very expensive because people have to prepare them by hand, but now we have sufficient machine learning tools so that we don't actually have to prepare them by hand. So that's the idea.
Yeah, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, that's
awesome.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Aubrey.
Mm-hmm.
think the surprise is always when you get you have a level of what you expect a situation to be like, and then if you're surprised, then it's different from what you expect, right?
That's right.
Cool.
And I'm surprised positively. I just want to say.
Thank you.
Stand somewhere there, I can get you in the reflection window.